Hello, I'm Scott Jasek with Inside Higher Ed. Welcome to our first discussion of technology issues with our technology bloggers. We have on the far left, Casey Green, who does our digital tweed blog, then Josh Kim, who does technology and learning, and then Tracy Metrano, who does law, policy, and IT. And we're talking today about the issues that are going to be hot at EDUCAUSE, which is about to get underway. Casey, I'm wondering what you see as the tone of the meeting is going to be, particularly in light of the tough economic times and the fact that everyone is talking about money these days.
Yeah, Scott, I think we're going to be hearing a bunch of things about money, and not just from the data that we'll release from the campus computing report in our annual survey on Thursday morning. It's a hard time because, unlike in the past where we've only had one downturn a decade, we've had two. And I think that that's hit particularly hard across all sectors. The pattern in the past and what seems to be emerging this year as well is that, not surprisingly, the privates are coming out of it faster and a little bit better than the publics. The state, you know, the problems in some of the states, and not just the chaos here in California, but elsewhere, is really playing havoc with budgets in general for higher ed and, you know, how that affects IT resources, and, you know, against which we've got an environment where there's no let up in demand. I mean, if anything, the demand and the expectation about IT resources, whether it's high speed network, wireless services for people who have consumer devices and all points in between, lecture capture, more instructional support, the challenge of Potemkin villages that we're offering more stuff online but not providing the user support. All of these, I think, are key dots on the landscape that in various ways will be part of the conversation at EDUCAUSE and beyond over the next couple of weeks.
Josh, what do you see?
Yeah, I think Casey, as usual, has it right on the money. And what I'm trying to figure out is, are we at the new normal? Is this just our life now of constant stress, too many projects, not enough people? And, you know, was there a golden era? I mean, I know Casey's been around for a lot of years. He might know kind of a golden time. I'd like to hear about that.
Each new wave of technology brings us more money, and then, you know, the economic things come into play. We got a lot of money in the late 80s as the micros came into the conversation. Same thing happened in the mid-late 90s with the arrival of the net. I think what's made it hard in this cycle, where we should be getting more money as we look at Web 2.0 and mobility, is that, again, we've had two downturns in a decade as opposed to one. We've not had the breathing space and the recovery that we've experienced in the past.
Tracy, how does it look to you economically?
Oh, I think I would tend to agree with what Casey and Joshua had to say. In terms of IT, I think the impact is being felt the greatest in the outsourcing area, and this remains the most significant question overall. How institutions are going to do outsourcing in terms of a strategic plan, build it into their business and efficiency plans for IT, and also aggregated and shared services, which I think will be one of the most important topics that arises at EDUCAUSE next week.
If I may, Scott, I think Tracy's point about shared services, I think this is the one that finally puts many campuses over the top in terms of having the conversation that they've tried to avoid for a long time. Whether, you know, particularly public institutions that have said, we can't share with anybody else. Well, the state authorities are going to start saying, you have to share. You better get your act together because we're not going to pay for duplicate services.
One of the things Josh has written about is that the economy is prompting some with larger publishers and other technology companies buying into lecture capture, which we just saw yesterday. Josh, could you maybe talk about what you see happening there?
Yeah, I mean, I think that this is an opportunity for the large players, for the publishing, for the publishers, for the large technology players like Microsoft or Oracle to very much buy into the higher education space and do so. I think we're so focused, or at least in my world, I'm so focused on North America. But I think the future is clearly Asia, Latin America. And I think we need to look beyond the U.S. for what these companies should be doing and will be doing in terms of how they'll be getting into these spaces where they're not currently in. And I think that there's a window that will close at pretty quickly. And we'll see if there's both the attention and focus on these large companies on the higher education space and some real leadership to make these big plays. I'll be interested in talking. I think EDUCAUSE is about talking to the companies. That's for me what you learn the most. And that's what I'll be looking to find out.
And do you think that these purchases that we've started to see and we'll see more of are going to be a net positive in terms of the services provided?
That's a great question. On the other side, I really do believe that for instance, the large publishers, if they're not going to suffer the same fate as the music publishers, they're going to have to change their models dramatically. Will this be a good thing for us in higher education? I'm optimistic about where we're going to go. But we'll see.
In some cases, you know, if you look at the McGraw acquisition of Tegrity, you could say, well, you know, no more ink. It's all digital and it gives them a new kind of content, but it's a very different kind of content than the kind that editors have worked with in the past. You know, which lecture do I take? Do I link with a McGraw-Hill accounting or economics book? And, you know, how do they compete if they want to bring that resource in as opposed to what's available on iTunes U? Or the Research Channel or some other places. I think that's one part of it. You know, in some cases, they're pushing their boundaries into new territories, perhaps to compete with some of the LMS providers and some of the integration we see there. Certainly Blackboard has had a real appetite for buying companies that create a kind of integration karatsu of resources and services. I think Joshua's point also about overseas is one that we forget because we're so myopic here in the U.S. The market looks very different in terms of post-secondary institutions and markets. Excuse me. Once you get out of North America, meaning U.S. and Canada, Brazil is a case in point. 80% of the population in post-secondary education in Brazil is in for-profit institutions, where the relationship between content providers is very different and institutions is very different than we see it here in the U.S., where the for-profits are rising dramatically in their headcount growth, but still only account for 8% of the headcount.
Tracy, do you see interesting things on the corporate purchasing and the shifts in strategy?
Well, I certainly see a challenge for higher education maintaining its autonomy in an overly commercialized marketplace. We probably, in higher education, not-for-profit, state or private, big or small, are the number one area that the commercial world is looking to colonize, conquer, absorb. I don't know exactly which verb to use. But we are vulnerable if the we remains a not-for-profit corporation. And call me a higher education fundamentalist, but I do believe that there is value in having higher education be in a not-for-profit corporate context. I think we have forgotten the social good that it does, and it's time for us to remember it before it might be too late.
Scott, can I respond? I mean, it's great to hear Tracy's points. I think I tend to take a different view. I tend to see people in companies and the for-profits. I see these people first as educators, and that they got into these educational technology companies because that's where they feel they can make a real difference, where there's a profit motive and agility. And I think we have not done enough at EDUCAUSE to make these people truly colleagues and partners and to work with them that they can honestly express what's going on and get them to move off their corporate messages. So I think we have a lot of room to see people in the for-profits as colleagues.
Oh, I don't disagree with – yeah, I don't disagree that we must be working with for-profit companies. I think the secret is in the dynamic between the not-for-profit sector that has a value to remain in that mode and the for-profit corporations that for profit motives can do some astounding things. I mean, technology would be truly the best example, especially with the challenges of demands and shrinking budgets going forward. But there is something that has to be regarded with value in the not-for-profit sector for higher education, and it being taken over by for-profit education is what I'm concerned about, not a healthy relationship between corporations and higher education.
Shifting away from the corporate, I wanted to talk a bit about student life. And Tracy, you wrote recently for us about the tragedy at Rutgers and issues raised by the way students are using technology. What kind of discussion would you like to see in EDUCAUSE about those issues?
Well, privacy has, will, and will continue to remain a key issue for American society and certainly for higher education. As the technology outstrips social norms and creates new challenges constantly in the area, not only of student life, but even in our own management of institutional information, while maintaining the need for some degree of privacy or autonomy for faculty to do their research, for students to live on campus in residential life and to operate as young autonomous adults in their own developmental cycle, and even for staff, notwithstanding federal laws that reduce privacy to zero in terms of, say, email owned by the institution. There may be a value in having a philosophy of lifting the floor of that law a little bit in order to create the kind of trust that people appreciate and return in kind to their institution by behaving accordingly.
I want to commend Tracy. I thought her post about the tragedy was eloquent. It was a compelling and obviously very personal statement, but also a compellingly, effectively professional statement about when the personal has policy consequences and when policy needs to protect the personal. And I think it's another instance, unfortunately, that this is an issue that campuses want nothing to do with. You know, given their druthers, they would say that, you know, this is like this is an off-campus issue. This is something else. We see this in some of our survey data. You know, campuses want nothing to do with social media, and yet, you know, we know that instances of cyberbullying and cyber harassment sort of carry into the campus environment. And one of the hardest parts, I think, for any of us in the campus community is that so much of this behavior is not new to being on campus. This is not rite of transition experience. You know, we've seen this in the cyberbullying tragedies that have occurred with younger kids across the country in recent years. These patterns and these behaviors, unfortunately, like some of the attitudes towards copyright and respect for digital property, occur well before anybody gets to a college campus, and yet there's an expectation that the college or university is responsible for remediation and fixing these attitudes and values. It's a huge and daunting challenge, you know, as some of the other things that are sort of dropped on the post-secondary community to address this one.
I look forward to your ideas at EDUCAUSE and elsewhere about our coverage. Thanks. Have a good day.